So last time we left off with chapter 4 of The Assassin and the Underworld. Also, guys, we're like 2/3 of the way through the book. I don't know. I'm very bad at like measuring how big things are. Anyways, we're on chapter 4. I forgot this was lemon water. I just took a sip of like, one, why is it cold? Two, why does it taste like lemons? Anyways. Chapter 4. Crouched in the shadows of a gargoyle the following afternoon, Selena shifted her numb legs and groaned softly. She usually opted to wear a mask, but with the rain, it would have limited her vision even further. Going without, though, made her feel somewhat exposed. The rain also made the stone slick, and she took extra care while adjusting her position. 6 hours. 6 hours spent on this rooftop, staring across the street at the two-story house Donovan had rented in the city. Oh, sorry. Skipped a line. Two-story house Donovan had rented for the duration of his stay. It was just off the fashionable avenue in the city, and was enormous, as far as city homes went. Made of solid white stone and capped with green clay shingles, it looked just like any other wealthy home in the city, right down to its intricately carved windowsills and doorways. The front lawn was manicured, and even in the rain, servants bustled around the property, bringing in food, flowers, and other supplies. That was the first thing she noticed, that people came and went all day, and there were guards everywhere. They looked closely at the faces of the servants who entered, scaring the daylights out of some of them. There was a whisper of boots against the ledge, and Sam nimbly slipped into the shadows of the gargoyle, returning from scouting the other side of the house. "A guard on every corner," Selena murmured, as Sam settled down beside her. "Three at the front door, two at the gate. How many did you spot in the back?" "One on either side of the house. Three more by the stables, and they don't look like cheap hands for hire either. Will we take them out or slip past them?" "I'd prefer not to kill them," she admitted. "But we'll see if we can slip past when the time comes. Seems like they're rotating every 2 hours. The off-duty guards go into the house." "Donovan's still away?" She nodded, inching nearer to him. Of course, it was just to absorb his warmth against the freezing rain. She tried not to notice when he pressed closer to her, too. "He hasn't returned." Donovan had left nearly an hour ago, closely flanked by a hulking brute of a man who looked hewn from granite. The bodyguard inspected the carriage, examined the coachman and the footman, held the door until Donovan was ensconced inside, and then slipped in himself. It seemed like Donovan knew very well just how coveted and delicate his list of slave sympathizers was. She'd seldom seen this kind of security. They'd already surveyed the house and grounds, noting everything from the stones of the building to what sort of latches sealed the windows to the distance between the nearby rooftops and the roof of the house itself. Even with the rain, she could see well enough into the second-story window to make out a long hallway. Some servants came out of rooms bearing sheets and blankets. Bedrooms, then. Four of them. There was a supply closet near the stairwell at the center of the hall. From the light that spilled into the hallway, she knew that the main stairwell had to be open and grand, just like the one in the Assassin's Keep. Not a chance of hiding, unless they found the servants' passages. They got lucky, though, when she spied a servant going into one of the second-floor rooms carrying a pile of the afternoon papers. A few minutes later, a maid lugged in a bucket and tools for sweeping out a fireplace, and then a man's servant brought in what looked like a bottle of wine. She hadn't seen anyone changing the linens in that room, and so they took special notice of the servants who entered and exited. It had to be the private study that Arabin had mentioned. Donovan probably maintained a formal study on the first floor, but if he were doing dark dealings, then moving his real business to a more hidden quarter of the house would make sense. But they still needed to figure out what time the meeting would take place. Right now, it could be at any point on the arranged day. "There he is," Sam hissed. Donovan's carriage pulled up, and the hulking bodyguard got out, scouring the street for a moment before he motioned for the businessman to emerge. Selena had a feeling that Donovan's rush to get into the house wasn't just about the downpour. They ducked back into the shadows again. "Where do you suppose he went?" Sam asked. She shrugged. His former wife's harvest moon party was tonight. Perhaps that had something to do with it, or the street festival that Melisande was hosting in the center of the city today. She and Sam were now crouching so close together that a toasty warmth was spreading up on one side of her. "Nowhere good, I'm sure." Sam let out a breathy laugh, his eyes still on the house. They were silent for a few minutes. At last, he said, "So the Mute Master's son." She almost groaned. "How close were you exactly?" He focused on the house, though. She'd noticed that he'd fisted his hands. "Just tell him the truth, idiot!" "Nothing happened with Ilias. It was only a bit of flirtation, but..." "Nothing happened," she said again. "Well," he said after a moment, "nothing happened with Lysandra. And nothing is going to. Ever." "And why exactly do you think I care?" It was her turn to keep her eyes fixed on the house. He nudged her with his shoulder. "Since we're friends now, I assumed you'd want to know." She was grateful that her hood concealed most of her burning hot face. "I think I preferred it when you wanted to kill me." "Sometimes I think so too. Certainly, my life would be more interesting." "I wonder though, if I'm helping..." "Certainly made my life more interesting. I wonder though, if I'm helping you, does it mean I get to be your second when you run the Assassin's Guild? Or does it just mean that I can boast that the famed Selena Sardothian finally finds me worthy?" She jabbed him with an elbow. "It means you should shut up and pay attention." They grinned at each other, and then they waited. Around sunset, which felt especially early that day, given the heavy cloud cover, the bodyguard emerged. Donovan was nowhere in sight, and the bodyguard motioned to the guards, speaking quietly to them before he strode down the street. "Off to run an errand?" Selena pondered. Sam inclined his head after the bodyguard, a suggestion that they follow. "Good idea." Selena's stiff limbs ached in protest as she slowly, carefully, inched away from the gargoyle. She kept her eyes on the nearby guards, not once looking away as she grabbed the roof ledge and hauled herself up it, Sam following suit. She wished she had the boots the Master Tinkerer was adjusting for her, but they wouldn't arrive until tomorrow. Her black leather boots, while supple and supportive, felt a bit traitorous on the rain-slick gutter of the roof. Still, she and Sam kept low and fast as they dashed along the roof edge, tracking the hulking man in the street below. Luckily, he turned down a back alley, and the next house was close enough that she could nimbly leap onto the adjacent roof. Her boots slid, but her gloved fingers grappled onto the green stone shingles. Sam landed flawlessly beside her, and, to her surprise, she didn't bite his head off when he grabbed the back of her cloak to help her stand. The bodyguard continued along the alley, and they trailed on the rooftops, shadows against the growing dark. At last, he came to a broader street where the gaps between houses were too big to jump, and Selena and Sam shimmied down a drainpipe. Their boots were soft as they hit the ground. They picked up a casual pace behind their quarry, arms linked, just two citizens of the capital on their way to somewhere, eager to get out of the rain. It was easy to spot him in the crowd, even as they reached the main avenue of the city. People jumped out of his way, actually. Melisande's street festival in honor of the Harvest Moon was in full swing, and people flocked to it despite the rain. Sam and Selena followed the bodyguard for a few more blocks, down a few more alleys. The bodyguard turned to look behind him only once, but he found them leaning casually against an alley wall, nearly cloaked figures taking shelter from the rain. With all the waste brought in by the Melisande convoy, the smaller street festivals that had already occurred, the streets and sewers were nearly overflowing with garbage. As they stalked the bodyguard, Selena heard people talking about how the city wardens had dammed up parts of the sewers to let them fill with rainwater. Tomorrow night, they were going to unleash them, causing a torrent in the sewers wild enough to sweep all the clinging trash into the Avery River. They'd done it before, apparently. If the sewers weren't flushed out every now and then, the filth would grow stagnant and reek even more. Still, Selena planned to be high, high above the streets by the time they unleashed those dams. There was sure to be some in-street flooding before it subsided, and she had no desire to walk through any of it. The bodyguard eventually went into a tavern on the cusp of the crumbling slums, and they waited for him to cross the street. Through the cracked windows, they could see him sitting at the bar, drinking mug after mug of ale. Selena began to wish fervently that she could be at the street festival instead. Well, if he has a weakness for alcohol, then perhaps that could be our way around him, Sam observed. She nodded, but didn't say anything. Sam looked toward the glass castle, its towers wreathed in mist. I wonder if Bardingale and the others are having any luck convincing the king to fund their road, he said. I wonder why she would even want it built, since she seems so eager to make sure the slave trade stays out of Melisandre for as long as possible. If anything, it means she has absolute faith that we won't fail, Selena said. When she didn't say anything else, Sam fell silent. An hour passed, and the bodyguard spoke to no one, paid the entire tab with a piece of silver, and headed back to Donegal's house. Despite the ale he'd consumed, his steps were steady, and by the time Sam and Selena reached the house, she was almost bored to tears, not to mention shivering with cold and unsure if her numb toes had fallen off inside her boots. They watched from a nearby street corner as the bodyguard went up the front steps. He held a position of respect then, if he wasn't made to enter through the back. But even with the bits of information they'd gathered that day, when they made the 20-minute trek across the city to the keep, Selena couldn't help feeling rather useless and miserable. Even Sam was quiet as they reached their home and merely told her that he'd see her in a few hours. The Harvest Moon party was that night, and the deal with Donegal 3 days away. Considering how little they'd been able to actually glean that day, perhaps she'd have to work harder than she thought to find a way to take out her quarry. Maybe Arabin's gift had been more of a curse. What a waste. She spent an hour soaking in her bathtub, running the hot water until she was fairly certain there wasn't any left for anyone else in the keep. Arabin himself had commissioned the running water outfit for the keep, and it cost as much as the building did, but she was forever grateful for it. Once the ice had melted away from her bones, she slipped into the black silk dressing robe Arabin had given her that morning, another of his presents, but still not enough that she'd forgive him anytime soon. She padded into her bedroom. A servant had started a fire, and she was about to begin dressing for the Harvest Moon party when she spotted the pile of papers on her bed. They were tied with a red string, and her stomach fluttered as she pulled out the note placed on top. Try not to stain them with your tears when you play. It took a lot of bribes to get these. She might have rolled her eyes had she not seen what lay before her. Sheet music, for the performance she'd seen last night. For the notes she couldn't get out of her mind, even a day later. She glanced again at the note. It wasn't Arabin's elegant script, but Sam's hurried scrawl. When in hell had he found the time today to get these? He must have gone out right after they'd returned. She sank onto the bed, flipping through the pages. The show had only debuted a few weeks ago. Sheet music for it wasn't even in circulation yet, nor would it be until it proved itself to be a success. That could be months, even years from now. She couldn't help but her smile. Despite the ongoing rain that night, the Harvest Moon party at Lafer Bardingale's riverfront house was so packed that Selena hardly had room to show off her exquisite golden blue dress or the fish fin combs she had positioned along the sides of her upswept hair. Everyone who was anyone in Rifthold was here. That is, everyone without royal blood. Though she could have sworn she saw a few members of the nobility mingling with the bejeweled crowd. The ballroom was enormous, its towering ceilings strung with paper lanterns of all colors and shapes and sizes. Garlands had been woven around the pillars lining one side of the room, and on the many tables, cornucopias overflowed with food and flowers. Young women in nothing more than corsets and lacy lingerie dangled from swings attached to the filigreed ceiling, and bare-chested young men with ornate ivory collars handed out wine. Selena had attended dozens of extravagant parties while growing up in Rifthold. She'd infiltrated functions hosted by foreign dignitaries and local nobility. She'd seen everything and anything until she thought nothing could surprise her anymore. But this party blew them all away. There was a small orchestra accompanied by two identical twin singers, both young women, both dark-haired, and both equipped with utterly ethereal voices. They had people swaying where they stood, their voices tugging everyone toward the packed dance floor. With Sam flanking her, Selena stepped from the stairs at the top of the ballroom. Arabin kept on her left, his silver eyes scanning the crowd. They crinkled with pleasure when their hostess greeted them at the bottom of the steps. In his pewter tunic, Arabin cut a dashing figure as he bowed over Bardingale's hand and pressed a kiss to it. The women watched him with dark, cunning eyes, a gracious smile on her red lips. Lafer, Bardingale, Arabin crooned, half turning to beckon to Selena. Allow me to introduce my niece, Diana, and my ward, Sam. His niece. That was always the story. Always the ruse whenever they attended these events together. Sam bowed, and Selena curtsied. The glimmer in Bardingale's gaze said she knew very well that Selena was not Arabin's niece. Selena tried not to frown. She'd never liked meeting clients face to face. It was better if they went through Arabin. Charmed, Bardingale said to her, then curtsied to Sam. Both of them are delightful, Arabin. A pretty nonsense statement, said by someone used to wielding pretty nonsense words to get what she wanted. Walk with me? She asked the King of Assassins, and Arabin extended an elbow. Just before they slipped into the crowd, Arabin glanced over his shoulder and gave Selena a rakish smile. Try not to get into too much trouble. Then Arabin and the lady were swallowed up by the throng of people, leaving Sam and Selena at the foot of the stairs. What now? Sam murmured, staring after Bardingale. His dark green tunic brought up the faint flecks of emerald in his brown eyes. Did you spot Donovan? They'd come here to see with whom Donovan associated, how many guards were waiting outside, and if he looked nervous. The exchange would happen 3 nights from now, in his upstairs study. But at what time? That was what she needed to find out more than anything, and tonight was the only chance she'd have to get close enough to him to do it. He's by the third pillar, she said, keeping her gaze on the crowd. In the shadows of the pillars lining half of the room, little seating areas had been erected on raised platforms. They were separated by black velvet curtains, private lounges for Bardingale's most distinguished guests. It was to one of these alcoves that she spotted Donovan making his way, his hulking bodyguard close behind. As soon as Donovan plopped into the plush cushions, four of the corset-clad girls slid into place beside him, smiles plastered on their faces. Doesn't he look cozy? Sam mused. I wonder how much Clarice stands to make off this party. That explained where the girls came from. Selena just hoped Lysandra wasn't here. One of the beautiful serving boys offered Donovan and the courtesans glasses of sparkling wine. The bodyguard, who stood by the curtains, sipped first before nodding to Donovan to take it. Donovan, one hand already wrapped around the bare shoulders of the girl beside him, didn't thank either his bodyguard or the serving boy. Selena felt her lip curl as Donovan pressed his lips to the neck of the courtesan. The girl couldn't have been older than 20. It didn't surprise her at all that this man found the growing slave trade appealing, and that he was willing to destroy his opponents to make his business arrangement a success. I have a feeling he's not going to get up for a while, Selena said, and when she turned to Sam, he was frowning. He'd always had a mixture of sorrow and sympathy for the courtesans, and such hatred for their clients. His mother's end hadn't been a happy one. Perhaps that was why he tolerated the insufferable Lysandra and her insipid companions. Someone almost knocked into Selena from behind, but she sensed the staggering man and easily sidestepped out of his path. This is a madhouse, she muttered, her gaze rising to the girls on the swings as they floated through the room. They arced their backs so far that it was a miracle their breasts stayed in their corsets. I can't even imagine how much Bardingale spent on this party. Sam was so close, his breath caressed her cheek. Selena was actually more curious about how much the hostess was spending on keeping Donovan distracted. Clearly, no cost was too great if she'd hired Selena to help destroy Donovan's trade agreement and get those documents into safe hands. But perhaps there was more to this assignment than just the slave trade agreement and blackmailing list. Perhaps Bardingale was tired of supporting her former husband's decadent lifestyle. Selena couldn't bring herself to blame her. Even though Donovan's cushioned alcove was meant to be private, he certainly wanted to be seen. And from the bottles of sparkling wine that had been set on the low table before him, she could tell he had no intention of getting up. A man who wanted to be approached by others, who wanted to feel powerful. He liked to be worshipped. And at a party hosted by his former wife, he had some nerve associating with those courtesans. It was petty and cruel, and if she thought about it. It was petty and cruel if she thought about it. But what good did knowing that do her? He rarely spoke to other men, it seemed. But who said his business partner had to be a man? Maybe it was a woman. Or a courtesan. Donovan was now slobbering over the neck of the girl on his other side, his hand roaming along her bare thigh. But if Donovan were in league with a courtesan, why would he wait until 3 days from now before making the document exchange? It couldn't be one of Clarice's girls. Or Clarice herself. Do you think he's going to meet with his conspirator tonight? Sam asked. Selena turned to him. No, I have a feeling that he's not foolish enough to actually do any dealings here. At least not with anyone except Clarice. Sam's face darkened. If Donovan enjoyed female company, well, that certainly worked in favor of her plan to get close to him, didn't it? She began winding her way through the crowd. What are you doing? Sam said, managing to keep up with her. She shot him a look over her shoulder, nudging people out of the way as she made for the alcove. Don't follow me, she said, but not harshly. I'm going to try something. Just stay here. I'll come find you when I'm done. He stared at her for a heartbeat, then nodded. Selena took a long breath through her nose as she mounted the steps and walked into the raised alcove where Donovan sat. And that was chapter 4. Ah, my allergies are killing me. My nose itches so much. Okay. On to chapter 5. The four courtesans noticed her, but Selena kept her eyes on Donovan, who looked up from the neck of the courtesan currently on the receiving end of his affection. His bodyguard was alert, but didn't stop her. Fool. She forced a little smile to her lips as Donovan's eyes roved freely. Up and down, down and up. That was why she'd opted for a lower cut dress than usual. It made her stomach turn, but she stepped closer. Only the low-lying table between her and Donovan's sofa. She gave a low, elegant curtsy. My lord, she purred. He was not a lord in any sense, but a man like that had to enjoy fancy titles, however unearned they might be. May I help you? He said, taking in her dress. She was definitely more covered up than the courtesans around him, but sometimes there was more allure in not seeing everything. Oh, I'm sorry to interrupt, she said, tilting her head so that the light from the lanterns caught in her eyes and set them sparkling. She knew well enough which of her features men tended to notice, and appreciate, most. But my uncle is a merchant, and he speaks so highly of you that I... She now looked at the courtesans as if suddenly noticing them, as if she were a good, decent girl, realizing the company he kept and trying not to become too embarrassed. Donovan seemed to sense her discomfort and sat up, removing his hand from the thigh of the girl next to him. The courtesans all went a bit rigid, shooting daggers in her direction. She might have grinned at them had she not been so focused on her act. Go on, my dear, Donovan said, his eyes now fixed on hers. Really, it was too easy. She bit her lip, tucking her chin down, demure, shy, waiting to be plucked. My uncle is sick tonight and couldn't attend. He was so looking forward to meeting you. And I thought I might make an introduction on his behalf, but I'm so terribly sorry to have interrupted you. She made to turn, counting down the heartbeats until... No, I'd be pleased to make the acquaintance. What is your name, my dear girl? She turned back, letting the light catch in her blue-gold eyes again. Diana Bracken. My uncle is Eric Bracken. She glanced at the courtesans, giving her best alarmed, innocent maiden look. I truly don't wish to interrupt you. Donovan kept drinking her in. Perhaps, if it would not be an inconvenience or an impertinence, we could call on you? Not tomorrow or the day after, since my uncle has some contact with the Viceroy of Belhaven to work on. But the day after that? 3 days from now is what I mean. She made a little coo of a laugh. It wouldn't be an impertinence in the least, Donovan crooned, leaning forward, mentioning Fenharrow's wealthiest city, and ruler, had done the trick. In fact, I much admire you for having the nerve to approach me. Not many men would, let alone young women. She almost rolled her eyes, but she just fluttered her eyelashes ever so slightly. Oh, thank you, my lord. What time would be convenient for you? Ah, Donovan said. Well, I have dinner plans that night. not a hint of nerves or a flicker of anxiety in his eyes. "But I am free for breakfast or lunch," he added with a growing smile. She sighed dramatically. "Oh no, I think I might have committed myself then, actually. What about tea that afternoon? You say you have dinner plans, but perhaps something before? Or maybe we'll just see you at the theater that night." He fell silent, and she wondered if he was growing suspicious. But she blinked, tucking her arms into her sides enough that her chest squeezed a bit more out of her neckline. It was a trick she'd used often enough to know it worked. "I would certainly like to have tea," he said at last. "But I'll also be at the theater after my dinner." She gave him a bright smile. "Would you like to join us in our box? My uncle has two of his contacts from the Viceroy of Bellhaven's court joining us, but I just know he'd be honored to have you with us as well." He cocked his head, and she could practically see the cold, calculating thoughts churning behind his eyes. "Come on," she thought, "take the bait." Contacts with wealthy businessmen and Bellhaven's Viceroy should be enough. "I'd be delighted," he said, giving her a smile that reeked of trained charm. "I'm sure you have a fine carriage to escort you to the theater, but we'd be doubly honored if you would use ours. We could pick you up after your dinner, perhaps." "I'm afraid my dinner is rather late. I'd hate to make you or your uncle tardy for the theater." "Oh, it wouldn't be a problem. What time does your dinner begin? Or end, I suppose, is the better question." A giggle. A twinkle in her eye that suggested the sort of curiosity in what a man like Donovan would be eager to show an inexperienced girl. He leaned farther forward. She wanted to claw at the skin his gaze raked over with such sensual consideration. "The meal should be over within an hour," he drawled. "If not sooner, only a quick meal with an old friend of mine. Why don't you stop by the house at 8:30? Her smile grew, genuine this time. 7:30 then. That's when the deal would occur. How could he be that foolish and that arrogant? He deserved to die just for being so irresponsible, so easily lured by a girl who was far too young for him. "Oh yes," she said. "Of course." She rattled off details about her uncle's business and how well they'd get along, and soon she was curtsying again, giving him another long look at her cleavage before she walked away. The courtesans were still glaring at her, and she could feel Donovan's gaze devouring her until the crowd swallowed her up. She made a show of going over to the food, keeping up the demure maiden facade, and when Donovan finally stopped watching, she let out a sigh. That had certainly gone well. She loaded a plate with food that made her mouth water. Roast boar, berries and cream, warm chocolate cake. From a few feet away, she found Lifer Bardingale observing her. The woman's dark eyes remarkably sad. Pitying. Or was it regret for what she had hired Selena to do? Bardingale approached, brushing against Selena's skirts on her way to the buffet table. But Selena chose not to acknowledge her. Whatever Arabin had told the women about her, she did not care. She didn't care to know. Though she would have liked to know what perfume Bardingale was wearing. It smelled like jasmine and vanilla. Sam was suddenly beside her, appearing in the silent-as-death way of his. "Did you get what you needed?" He followed Selena as she added more food to her plate. Lafer took a few scoops of berries and a dollop of cream and disappeared back into the crowd. Selena grinned, glancing to the alcove where Donovan had now returned to his hired company. She deposited her plate on the table. "I certainly did. It appears he's unavailable at 7:30 in the evening that day." "So we have our meeting time," Sam said. "Indeed, we do." She turned to him with a triumphant smirk, but Sam was now watching Donovan, his frown growing as the man continued pawing at the girls around him. The music shifted, becoming livelier, the twins' voices rising in a wraith-like harmony. "And now that I got what I came here for, I want to dance," Selena said. "So drink up, Sam Cortland. We're not washing our hands in blood tonight." She danced and danced. The beautiful youths of Melisande had gathered near the platform that held the twin singers, and Selena had gravitated toward them. Bottles of sparkling wine passed from hand to hand, mouth to mouth. Selena swigged from all of them. Around midnight, the music changed, going from organized and elegant dances to a frenzied, sensual sound that had her clapping her hands and stomping her feet in time. The Melisanders seemed eager to writhe and fling themselves about. If there were music and movements that embodied the wildness and recklessness and immortality of youth, they were here, on this dance floor. Donovan remained where he sat on the cushions, drinking bottle after bottle. He never once glanced in her direction. Whoever he had thought Diana Bracken was, she was forgotten. She was now forgotten. Good. Sweat ran along every part of her body, but she tipped her head back, arms upraised, content to bask in the music. One of the courtesans on the swings flew by so low that their fingers brushed. The touch sent sparks shooting through her. This was more than a party. It was a performance, an orgy, and a call to worship at the altar of excess. Selena was a willing sacrifice. The music shifted again, a riot of pounding drums and the staccato notes of the twins. Sam kept a respectful distance, dancing alone, occasionally detangling himself from the arms of a girl who saw his beautiful face and tried to seize him for her own. Selena tried not to smirk when she saw him politely but firmly telling the girl to find someone else. Many of the older partygoers had long since left, ceding the dance floor to the young and beautiful. Selena focused long enough to check on Donoval and to see Arabin sitting with Bardingale in another one of the nearby alcoves. A few others sat with them, and though glasses of wine littered their table, they all had lowered brows and tight-lipped expressions. While Donoval had come here to feast off his former wife's fortune, it seemed like she had other thoughts on how to enjoy her party. What sort of strength had it taken to accept that assassinating her former husband was the only option left? Or was it a weakness? The clock struck 3. 3? How had so many hours passed? A glimmer of movement caught her eye by the towering doors atop the stairs. 4 young men wearing masks stood atop the steps, surveying the crowd. It took all of 2 heartbeats for her to see that the dark-haired youth was their ringleader, and that the fine clothes and masks they wore marked them as nobility. Probably nobles looking to escape a stuffy function and savor the delights of Rifthold. The masked strangers swaggered down the steps, one of them keeping close to the dark-haired youth. That one had a sword, she noticed, and from his tense shoulders, she could tell he wasn't entirely pleased to be here. But the lips of the ringleader parted in a grin as he stalked into the crowd. Gods above, even with the mask obscuring half his features, he was handsome. She danced as she watched him, and, as if he somehow sensed her all this time, their eyes met from across the room. She gave him a smile, then deliberately turned back toward the singers, her dancing a little more careful, a little more inviting. She found Sam frowning at her. She gave him a shrug. It took the masked stranger a few minutes, and a knowing smile from her to suggest that she, too, knew exactly where he was. But soon, she felt a hand slide around her waist. "Some party," the stranger whispered in her ear. She twisted to see sapphire eyes gleaming at her. "Are you from Melisande?" She swayed with the music. "Perhaps." His smile grew. She itched to pull off the mask. Any young nobles who were out at this hour were certainly not here for innocent purposes. Still, who was to say that she couldn't have some fun, too? "What's your name?" he asked above the roar of the music. She leaned close. "My name is Wind," she whispered, "and rain, and bone, and dust. My name is a snippet of a half-remembered song." He chuckled, a low, delightful sound. She was drunk and silly and so full of the glory of being young and alive and in the capital of the world that she could hardly contain herself. "I have no name," she purred. "I am whoever the keepers of my fate tell me to be." He grasped her by her wrist, running a thumb along the sensitive skin underneath. "Then let me call you mine for a dance or two." She grinned, but someone was suddenly between them, a tall, powerfully built person, Sam. He ripped the stranger's hand off her wrist. "She's spoken for," he growled, all too close to the young man's masked face. The stranger's friend was behind him in an instant, his bronze eyes fixed on Sam. Selena grabbed Sam's elbow. "Enough," she warned him. The masked stranger looked Sam up and down, then held up his hands. "My mistake," he said, but winked at Selena before he disappeared into the crowd, his armed friend close behind. Selena whirled to face Sam. "What in the hell was that for?" "You're drunk," he told her, so close her chest brushed his. And he knew it, too. So, even as she said it, someone dancing wildly crashed into her and set her reeling. Sam caught her around the waist, his hands firm on her as he kept her from falling to the ground. "You'll thank me in the morning." "Just because we're working together doesn't mean I'm suddenly incapable of handling myself." His hands were still on her waist. "Let me take you home." She glanced toward the alcoves. Donoval was passed out cold on the shoulder of a very bored-looking courtesan. Arabin and Bardingale were deep in their conversation. "No," she said. I don't need an escort. I'll go home when I feel like it. She slipped out of his grasp, slamming into the shoulder of someone behind her. The man apologized and moved away. Besides, Selena said, unable to stop the words or the stupid, useless jealousy that grabbed control of her. Don't you have Lysandra or someone equally for hire to be with? I don't want to be with Lysandra or anyone else for hire, he said through gritted teeth. He reached for her hand. And you're a damned fool for not seeing it. She shook off his grip. I am what I am, and I don't particularly care what you think of me. Maybe once he might have believed that, but now? Well, I care what you think of me. I care enough that I stayed at this disgusting party just for you. And I care enough that I attend 1,000 more like it so I can spend a few hours with you when you aren't looking at me like I'm not worth the dirt beneath your shoes. That made her anger stumble. She swallowed hard, her head spinning. We have enough going on with Donovan. I don't need to be fighting with you. She wanted to rub her eyes, but she would have ruined the cosmetics on them. She let out a long sigh. Can't we just try to enjoy ourselves right now? Sam shrugged, but his eyes were still dark and gleaming. If you want to dance with that man, then go ahead. It's not about that. Then tell me what it's about. She began wringing her fingers, then stopped herself. Look, she said. The music so loud it was hard to hear her own thoughts. Sam, I don't know how to be your friend yet. I don't know if I know how to be anyone's friend. And can we just talk about this tomorrow? He shook his head slowly, but gave her a smile, even though it didn't reach his eyes. Sure, if you can remember anything tomorrow, he said with forced lightness. She made herself smile back at him. He jerked his chin toward the dancing. Go have fun. We'll talk in the morning. He stepped closer, as if he'd kiss her cheek, but then thought better of it. She couldn't tell if she was disappointed or not as he squeezed her shoulder instead. With that, he vanished into the crowd. Selena stared after him until a young woman pulled her into a circle of dancing girls, and the revelry took hold of her again. The rooftop of her new apartment looked out over the Avery River, and Selena sat on the walled edge, her legs dangling off the side. The stone beneath her was chill and damp, but the rain had stopped during the night, and fierce winds had blown the clouds away as the stars faded and the sky lightened. The sun broke over the horizon, flooding the snaking arm of the Avery with light. It became a living band of gold. The capital began to stir, chimneys puffing up smoke from the first of the day's fires, fishermen calling to one another from the nearby docks, young children rushing through the streets with bundles of wood or the morning papers or buckets of water. Behind her, the glass castle shimmered in the dawn. She hadn't been to her new apartment since she'd returned from the desert, so she'd taken a few minutes to walk through the spacious rooms hidden on the upper floor of a fake warehouse. It was the last place anyone would expect her to purchase a home, and the warehouse itself was filled with bottles of ink, a supply no one was likely to break in to steal. This was a place that was hers and hers alone, or it would be, as soon as she told Arabin she was leaving. Would she do as soon as she'd finished this business with Donovan? Or sometime soon after that, maybe. She inhaled the damp morning air, letting it wash through her. Seated on the roof ledge, she felt wonderfully insignificant, a mere speck in the vastness of the great city. And yet all of it was hers for the taking. Yes, the party had been delightful, but there was more to the world than that. Bigger things, more beautiful things, more real things. Her future was hers, and she had three trunks of gold hidden in her room that would solidify it. She could make of her life what she wanted. Selena leaned back on her hands, drinking in the awakening city, and as she watched the capital, she had the joyous feeling that the capital watched her back. And that was chapter 5. Clayton, thank you for the 100 bits. I love you too, Clayton, and I am doing great. Less than a week and a half until you get here, I'm pretty sure. Also, Bryce, thank you for the hydrate. My Discord is ringing. One moment. There we go. Sorry, my MCC Rising group is hopping onto a call right now in our group chat, so it was flashing on my other monitor. I needed to dismiss it. Also, I would like to point out in that last chapter, when they talked about the masked royals that came to the party, I don't know if you guys picked up on this, but the dark-haired, blue-eyed royal is hinted to actually be Dorian, and his friend closely behind him was Kael. So they actually met before they officially met. Yeah. Yeah, and then the two others are just meant to be, like, some other miscellaneous royals from the castle. But yeah, that's what they were described as. Because they're just, if you, like, actually pay attention, the description of their hair and their eyes were the exact same as Dorian and Kael when they are first described in the book. Yeah, it's cool how there's so many things that are intertwined. No, Dorian has black hair. Dorian has black hair with blue eyes. Kael is brown hair, brown eyes, or copper eyes. And Selena is blonde. Selena has blonde hair with teal eyes ringed with gold. And then Sam, I'm pretty sure, is also brown hair, brown and green eyes, if I remember correctly. Anyways, once we get to a certain point in the book series and certain additional characters are introduced, I actually have a book sleeve that the inside is a poster of what all of the characters, what all the main characters look like. So once we get to a certain point in the book where all of those characters are finally introduced, I will show you guys what they look like. On to chapter 6. Since she'd forgotten to do it at the party the night before, she meant to thank Sam for the music during their usual tumbling lesson after breakfast. But several of the other assassins were also in the training hall, and she had no desire to explain the gift to any of the older men. They would undoubtedly take it the wrong way. Not that they particularly cared about what she was up to. They did their best to stay out of her way, and she didn't bother to get to know them either. Besides, her head was throbbing thanks to staying up until dawn and drinking all that sparkling wine. So she couldn't even think of the right words just now. She went through her training exercises until noon, impressing their instructor with the new ways she'd learned to move while she was in the Red Desert. She felt Sam watching her from the mats a few feet away. She tried not to look at his shirtless chest, gleaming with sweat, as he took a running jump, nimbly flipping through the air and landing almost soundlessly on the ground. By the word, he was fast. He'd certainly spent the summer training, too. M'lady, the instructor coughed, and she turned to him, giving a glare that warned him not to comment. She slid into a backbend, then flipped out of it, her legs smoothly rising over her head and back to the floor. She landed in a kneel and looked up to see Sam approaching, stopping before her. He gave the instructor a sharp jerk of his chin, and the stocky, compact man found somewhere else to be. "He was helping me," Selena said. Her muscles quivered as she stood. She trained hard this morning, despite how little sleep she'd gotten, which had nothing to do with the fact that she hadn't wanted to spend a moment alone with Sam in the training hall. "He's here every other day. I don't think you're missing anything vital," Sam replied. She kept her gaze on his face. She'd seen Sam shirtless before. She'd seen all of the assassins at various stages of undress thanks to their training. But this felt different. "So," she said, "are we breaking into Donovan's house tonight?" She kept her voice down. She didn't particularly like sharing anything with her fellow assassins. Ben she'd once told everything to, but he was dead and buried. "Now that we know the meeting time, we should get into the upstairs study and get a sense of what and how many documents there are before he shares them with his partner." Since the sun had finally decided to make an appearance, it made daytime stalking next to impossible. He frowned, running a hand through his hair. "I can't. I want to, but I can't. Lysandra has a pre-bidding rehearsal, and I'm on guard duty. I can meet you after if you want to wait for me." "No, I'll go myself. It shouldn't be that hard." She started from the training room, and Sam followed her, keeping close to her side. "It's going to be dangerous." "Sam, I freed 200 slaves in Skulls Bay and took down Rolf. I think I can handle this." They reached the main entranceway of the keep. "And you did that with my help. Why don't I stop by Donovan's after I finish and see if you need me?" She patted his shoulder, his bare skin sticky with sweat. "Do whatever you want, though I have a feeling I'll already be done by that point. But I'll tell you all about it tomorrow morning." she crooned, pausing at the front of the grand staircase. He grabbed her hand. Please be careful. Just get a look at the documents and go. We've still got 2 days until the exchange. If it's too dangerous, then we can try tomorrow. Don't put yourself at risk. Doors to the keep swung open and Sam dropped her hand as Lysandra and Clarice came sweeping in. Lysandra's face was flushed, making her green eyes sparkle. Oh, Sam! Lysandra said, rushing toward him with outstretched hands. Selena bristled. Sam grasped Lysandra's slender fingers politely. From the way she drank him in, especially his shirtless torso, Selena had no trouble believing that 2 days from now, as soon as her bidding night was over and she could be with whoever she wanted, she'd seek out Sam. And who wouldn't? Another luncheon with Arabin? Sam asked, but Lysandra wouldn't let go of his hands. Madame Clarice gave Selena a curt nod as she bustled past, heading straight for Arabin's study. The brothel madam and the King of Assassins had been friends for as long as Selena had been here, and Clarice had never said more than a few words to her. Oh no, we're here for tea. Arabin promised a silver tea service, Lysandra said, her words somehow feeling tossed in Selena's direction. You must join us, Sam. Ordinarily, Selena would have bitten the girl's head off with the insult. Lysandra was still grasping Sam's hands. As if he sensed it, Sam wriggled his fingers away. He started. You should go, Selena said. Lysandra looked between them. I have work to do anyway. I don't get to be the best simply by lying on my back all day. A cheap shot, but Lysandra's eyes flashed. Selena gave her a razor-sharp smile. Not that she had wanted to keep talking to Sam, or invite him to listen to her practice the music he'd gotten her, or spend any more time with him than was absolutely necessary. He swallowed. Have lunch with me, Selena. Lysandra clicked her tongue and strode off, muttering, Why would you want to have lunch with her? I'm busy, Selena said. It wasn't a lie. She did still have to finalize her plans to break into the house to find more about Donovan's documents. She jerked her chin toward Lysandra and the sitting room beyond her. Go enjoy yourself. Without wanting to see what he chose, she kept her eyes on the marble floors, the teal drapes, and the gilded ceiling as she walked to her room. The walls of Donovan's house were unguarded. Wherever he'd gone tonight, from the look of his clothes, probably to the theater or a party, he'd taken several of his guards with him. Though she hadn't counted his hulking bodyguard in their ranks, perhaps the bodyguard had the night off. It still left several guards patrolling the grounds, not to mention whoever was inside. While she loathed the thought of getting her new black suit wet, Selena was grateful for the rain that had started again at the sundown, even if it meant foregoing her usual mask in order to keep her weather-limited senses open. Thankfully, the heavy downpour also meant that the guard on the side of the house didn't even notice her slipping right past him. The second floor was fairly high up, but the window was darkened and the latch was easily unlocked from the outside. She'd mapped the house already. If she was correct, and she was certain she was, that window led right into the second floor study. Listening carefully, she waited until the guard was looking the other way and began to climb. Her new boots found their grip on the stone, and her fingers had no trouble at all seeking out cracks. The suit was a little heavier than her usual tunic, but with the built-in blades and the gauntlets, she didn't have the additional encumbrance of a sword on her back or daggers at her waist. There were even 2 knives built into her boots. This was one gift from Arabin that she'd get a lot of use out of. But while the rain quieted and clouded her, it also masked the sound of anyone approaching. She kept her eyes and ears wide open, but no other guards rounded the corner of the house. The additional risk was worth it. Not that she knew what time the meeting would take place. Now that she knew the time that the meeting would take place, she had 2 days to gather as much specific information as she could about the documents, namely how many pages there were and where Donovan hid them. In a few moments, she was at the sill of the study window. The guard below didn't even look up at the house towering behind him. Top-notch guards indeed. One glance inside showed a darkened room, a desk littered with papers and nothing else. He wouldn't be so foolish as to leave the lists out in plain sight. But Selena hauled herself onto the ledge, and the slender knife from her boot gleamed dully as it wedged into the slight gap between the window doors. 2 angled jabs, a flick of her wrist, and she eased the window open, praying for silent hinges. One of them creaked quietly, but the other swung away without a sound. She slid into the study, boots quiet on the ornate rug. Carefully holding her breath, she eased the window shut again. She sensed the attack a heartbeat before it happened. And that was chapter 6. Ah. Guys, my nose is, like, really bothering me. It's really annoying. Oh, also just a page update. We are on page 292 out of 432. So we are definitely over halfway done with the book. Moving on to chapter 7. Selena whirled and ducked, the other knife from her boot instantly in her hand, and the guard went down with a groan. She struck fast as an asp, a move she'd learned in the Red Desert. As she yanked the knife from his thigh, hot blood pumped onto her hand. Another guard swiped a sword at her, but she met it with both her knives before kicking him squarely in the stomach. He staggered back, yet not fast enough to escape the blow to his head that knocked him out. Another maneuver the mute master had taught her while she'd been studying how the desert animals moved. In the darkness of the room, she felt the reverberations as the guard's body slammed into the floor. But there were others, and she counted three more grunting and moaning as they crumpled around her, before someone grabbed her from behind. There was a vicious thump against her head, and something wet and putrid pressed to her face, and then, oblivion. Selena awoke, but she didn't open her eyes. She kept her breathing steady, even as she inhaled the reek of filth and the damp, rotten air around her. And she kept her ears open, even as she heard the chuckle of male voices and the gurgle of water. She kept very still, even as she felt the ropes that bound her to the chair, and the water that was already up to her calves. She was in the sewer. Splashes approached, heavy enough that the sewer water showered her lap. "I think that's enough sleeping," said a deep voice. A powerful hand slapped her cheek. Through stinging eyes, she found the hatchet-hewn face of Donovan's bodyguard smiling at her. "Hello, lovely. Thought we didn't notice you spying on us for days, did you? You might be good, but you're not invisible." Behind him, four guards loitered by an iron door, and beyond it was another door, through which she could see a set of steps that led upward. It must be a door into the cellar of the house. Several of the older houses in Riftold had such doors, escape routes during wars, ways to sneak in scandal-worthy guests, or merely an easy way to deposit the household's waste. The double doors were to keep out the water, airtight, and made long ago by skilled craftsmen who had used magic to cope the thresholds with water-repelling spells. "There are a lot of rooms to break into this house," the bodyguard said. "Why'd you choose the upstairs study? And where's your friend?" She gave him a crooked grin, all the while taking in the cavernous sewer around her. The water was rising. She didn't want to think about what was floating in it. "Will this be an interrogation, then torture, then death?" she asked him. "Or am I getting the order wrong?" The man grinned right back at her. "Smartass, I like it." His accent was thick, but she understood him well enough. He braced his hands on either arm of her chair. With her own arms bound behind her back, she only had the freedom to move her face. "Who sent you?" Her heart beat wildly, but her smile didn't fade. Withstanding torture was a lesson she'd learned long ago. "Why do you assume anyone sent me? Can't a girl be independent?" The wooden chair groaned under his weight, as he leaned so close their noses were almost touching. She tried not to inhale his hot breath. "Why else would a little bitch like you break into this house? I don't think you're after jewels or gold." She felt her nostrils flare, but she wouldn't make her move, not until she knew she had no chance to glean information from him. "If you're going to torture me," she drawled, "then get it started. I don't particularly enjoy the smell down here." The man pulled back, his grin unfaltering. "Oh, we're not going to torture you. Do you know how many spies and thieves and assassins have tried to take down Donovan? We're beyond asking questions. If you don't want to talk, then fine. Don't talk. We've learned how to deal with you filth." "Philip," one of the guards said, pointing with his sword down the dark tunnel of the sewer. "We've got to go." "Right," Philip said, turning back to Selena. See, I figure if someone is foolish enough to send you here, then you must be expendable. And I don't think anyone will look for you when they flood the sewers. Not even your friend. In fact, most people are staying off the streets right now. You capital dwellers don't like getting your feet dirty, do you? Her heart pounded harder, but she didn't break his gaze. Too bad they won't get all the trash, she said, batting her eyelashes. No, he said, but they'll get you. Or at least, the river will get your remains, if the rats have left enough. Philip patted her cheek hard enough to sing. As if the sewers had heard him, a rush of water began sounding from the darkness. Oh no, no! He splashed back to the landing where the guards stood. She watched them stride out through the second door, then up the stairs, then... Enjoy your swim, Philip said, and slammed the iron door shut behind him. Darkness and water. In the moments it took for her to adjust to the dim streetlight leaking in through the grate high above, water gushed against her legs. It was up to her lap in an instant. She cursed violently and wriggled hard enough against the ropes. But as the ropes cut into her arms, she remembered the built-in blades. It was a testament to the inventor's skill that Philip hadn't found them, even though he must have searched her. Yet the bindings were almost too tight for her to release them. She twisted her wrists, fighting for any shred of space to flick her hand. The water pooled around her waist. They must have built the sewer dam at the other end of the city. It would take a few minutes before it completely flooded this part. The rope wouldn't budge, but she flicked her wrist, doing as the master tinkerer had told her, again and again. Then, at last, the whine and splash of the blade as it shot out. Pain danced down the side of her hand, and she swore. She'd cut herself on the damn thing. Thankfully, it didn't feel deep. Immediately, she started at the ropes, her arms aching while she twisted them as far as she could to angle against the bindings. They should have used iron shackles. There was a sudden release of tension around her middle, and she almost fell face first into the swirling black water as the rope gave. Two heartbeats later, the rest of the ropes were off, though she cringed as she plunged her hands into the filthy water to cut her feet from the chair legs. When she stood, the water was at her thighs, and cold. Icy, icy cold. She felt things sliding against her as she splashed for the landing, struggling to keep upright in the fierce current. Rats were being swept past by the dozen, their squeals of terror barely audible over the roar of the water. By the time she reached the stone steps, the water was already pooling there, too. She tried the iron handle. It was locked. She tried to plunge one of her blades in alongside the threshold, but it bounced back. The door was sealed so tightly that nothing was getting through. She was trapped. Selena looked down the length of the sewer. Rain was still pouring in from above, but the streetlights were bright enough that she could see the curved walls. There had to be some ladder to the street. There had to be. She couldn't see any, not near her, and the grates were so high up that she'd have to wait until the sewer filled entirely before trying her luck. But the current was so strong that she'd probably be swept away. Think, she whispered. Think, think. Water rose higher on the landing, lapping now at her ankles. She kept her breathing calm. Panicking would accomplish nothing. Think! She scanned the sewer. There might be a ladder, but would be farther down. That meant braving the water. And the dark. On her left, the water rose endlessly, rushing in from the other half of the city. She looked to her right. Even if there wasn't a grate, she might make it to the Avery. It was a very, very big might, but it was better than waiting here to die. Selena sheathed her blades and plunged into the smelly, oily water. Her throat closed up, but she willed herself to keep from vomiting. She was not swimming through the entire capital's refuse. She was not swimming through rat-infested waters. She was not going to die. The current was faster than she'd expected, and she pulled against it. Grates passed overhead, even ever nearer, but still too distant. And then there, on the right, midway up the wall, several feet above the waterline, was a small tunnel opening. It was made for a solitary worker. Rainwater leaked out over the lip of the tunnel. Somewhere it had to lead to the street. She swam hard for the wall, fighting to keep the current from sweeping her past the tunnel. She hit the wall and clung to it, easing down the side. The tunnel was hard, was high up enough that she had to reach her fingers, aching as they dug into the stone. But she had a grip, and even though pain lanced through her nails, she hauled herself onto the narrow passage. It was so small inside that she had to lie flat on her belly, and it was full of mud, and the gods knew what else. But there, far ahead, was a shaft of lamplight, an upward tunnel that led to the street. Behind her, the sewer continued flooding, the roaring waters near deafening. If she didn't hurry, she'd be trapped. With the ceiling so low, she had to keep her head down, her face nearly in the putrid mud, as she stretched out her arms and pulled. Inch by inch, she dragged herself through the tunnel, staring at the light ahead. Then the water reached the level of the tunnel. Within moments, it swept past her feet, past her legs, then her abdomen, and then her face. She crawled faster, not needing light to tell how bloody her hands were. Each bit of grit inside the cuts was like fire. Go, she thought to herself with each thrust and pull of her arms, each kick of her feet. Go, go, go! The word was the only thing that kept her from screaming, because once she started screaming, that was when she'd concede to death. The water in the passage was a few inches deep by the time she hit the upward tunnel, and she nearly sobbed at the sight of the ladder. It was probably 15 feet to the surface. Through the circular holes in the large grate, she spied a hovering street lamp. She forgot the pain in her hands as she climbed the rusted ladder, willing it not to break. Water filled the tunnel bottom, swirling with debris. She was quickly at the top and even allowed herself a little smile as she pushed against the round grate. But it didn't budge. She balanced her feet on the rickety ladder and pushed with both hands. It still didn't move. She angled her body in the upper rung so that her back and shoulders braced against the grate and threw herself into it. Nothing. Not a groan, not a hint of metal giving way. It had to be rusted shut. She pounded against it until she felt something crack in her hand. Her vision flashed with pain, black and white sparks dancing, and she made sure the bone wasn't broken before pounding again. Nothing. Nothing. The water was close now, its muddy froth so near that she could reach down and touch it. She threw herself into the grate one last time. It didn't move. If people were off the streets until the mandatory flooding was over, rainwater poured into her mouth, her eyes, her nose. She banged against the metal, praying for anyone to hear her over the roar of the rain, for anyone to see the muddy, bloodied fingers straining upward from an ordinary city grate. The water hit her boots. She shoved her fingers through the grate holes and began screaming. She screamed until her lungs burned, screamed for help, for anyone to hear, and then, Selena? It was a shout, and it was close, and Selena sobbed when she heard Sam's voice, nearly muffled by the rain and roaring waters beneath her. He said he'd come by after helping with Lysandra's party. He must have been on his way to or from Donovan's house. She wriggled her fingers through the grate hole, pounding with her other hand against the grate. Here! In the sewer! She could feel the rumble of steps, and then, holy gods! Sam's face swam into view through the grate. I've been looking for you for 20 minutes, he said. Hold on! His calloused fingers latched onto the holes. She saw them go white with strain, saw his face turn red. Then, he swore. The water had reached her calves. Get me the hell out of here! Shove with me, he breathed, and as he pulled, she pushed. The grate wouldn't move. They tried again and again. The water hit her knees. By whatever luck, the grate was far enough away from Donovan's house that the guards couldn't hear them. Get as high as you can, he barked. She already was, but she didn't say anything. She caught the flash of a knife and heard the scrape of a blade against the grate. He was trying to loosen the metal by using the blade as a lever. Push on the other side, she pushed. Dark water lapped at her thighs. The knife snapped in two. Sam swore violently and began yanking on the grate cover again. Come on, he whispered, more to himself than to her. Come on! The water was around her waist now, and over her chest a moment after that. Rain continued streaming in through the grate, blinding her senses. Sam, she said. I'm trying! Sam, she repeated. No, he spat, hearing her tone. No! He began screaming for help then. Selena pressed her face to one of the holes in the grate. Help wasn't going to come. Not fast enough. She'd never given much thought to how she died, but drowning somehow felt fitting. It was a river in her native country of Terracid that had almost claimed her life 9 years ago, and now it seems that whatever bargain she'd struck with the gods that night was finally over. The water would have her, one way or another, no matter how long it took. Please, Sam begged as he beat and yanked on the gate, then tried to wedge another dagger under the lid. Please, don't. She knew he wasn't speaking to her. The water hit her neck. Please, Sam moaned, his fingers now touching hers. She'd have one last breath, her last words. Take my body home to Terrace and Sam, she whispered, and with a gasping breath, she went under. And that was chapter 7. Hi, Chaz! Thank you for redeeming cat ears! Cat ears have been acquired. Music was on point. For real. Thank you, Chaz, for this awesome playlist. And Spotify's shuffle algorithm, which somehow makes music line up to the part I'm reading. And now, on to chapter 8. Breathe! Someone was roaring as they pounded on her chest. Breathe! And just like that, her body seized, and water rushed out of her. She vomited onto the cobblestones, coughing so hard she convulsed. Oh, gods, Sam moaned. Through her streaming eyes, she found him kneeling beside her. His head hung between his shoulders as he braced his palms on his knees. Behind him, two women were exchanging relieved yet confused expressions. One of them held a crowbar. Beside her lay the great cover, and around them spilled water from the sewer. She vomited again. She took 3 baths in a row and ate food only with the intention of vomiting it up to clear out any trace of the vile liquid inside her. She plunged her torn, aching hands into a vat of hard liquor, biting down her scream but savoring the disinfectant burning through whatever had been in that water. Once that proved calming to her repulsion, she ordered her bathtub filled with the same liquor and submerged herself in it too. She'd never feel clean again, even after her 4th bath, which had been immediately after her liquor bath. She felt like grime coated every part of her. Erwin had cooed and fussed, but she'd ordered him out. She ordered everyone out. She'd take another 2 baths in the morning, she promised herself as she climbed into bed. There was a knock on her door, and she almost barked at the person to go away, but Sam's head popped in. The clock read past 12, but his eyes were still alert. "You're awake," he said, slipping inside without so much as a nod of permission from her. Not that he needed it. He'd saved her life. She was in his eternal debt. On the way home, he'd told her that after Lysandra's bidding rehearsal, he'd gone to Donovan's house to see if she needed any help. But when he got there, the house was quiet, except for the guards who kept sniggering about something that had happened. He'd been searching the surrounding streets for any sign of her when he heard her screaming. She looked at him from where she lay in bed. "What do you want?" Not the most gracious words to someone who had saved her life, but hell, she was supposed to be better than him. How could she say she was the best when she needed Sam to rescue her? The thought made her want to hit him. He just smiled slightly. "I wanted to see if you were finally done with all the washing. There's no hot water left." She frowned. "Don't expect me to apologize for that." "Do I ever expect you to apologize for anything?" In the candlelight, the lovely panes of his face seemed velvet smooth and inviting. "You could have let me die," she mused. "I'm surprised you weren't dancing with glee over the grate." He let out a low laugh that traveled along her limbs, warming her. "No one deserves that sort of death, Selena. Not even you. And besides, I thought we were beyond that." She swallowed hard but was unable to break his gaze. "Thank you for saving me." His brows rose. She'd said it once on their way back, but it had been a quick, breathless string of words. This time, it was different. Though her fingers ached, especially her broken nails, she reached for his hand. And I'm sorry. She made herself look at him, even as his features crossed into incredulity. I can't say that word. Whatever that word is. "I'm sorry for involving you in what happened in Skull's Bay, and for what Erebin did to you because of it." "Ah," he said, as if he somehow understood some great puzzle. He examined their linked hands, and she quickly let go. The silence was suddenly too charged. His face too beautiful in the light. She lifted her chin and found him looking at the scar along her neck, the narrow ridge that would fade someday. "Her name was Ansel," she said, her throat tightening. "She was my friend." Sam slowly sat on the bed, and then the whole story came out. Sam only asked questions when he needed clarification. The clock chimed 1 by the time she finished telling him about the final arrow she'd fired at Ansel, and how, even with her heart breaking, she'd given her friend an extra minute before releasing what would have been a killing shot. When she stopped speaking, Sam's eyes were bright with sorrow and wonder. "So that was my summer," she said with a shrug. "A grand adventure for Selena Sardothian, isn't it?" But he merely reached out and ran his fingers down the scar on her neck, as if he could somehow erase the wound. "I'm sorry," he said, and she knew he meant it. "So am I. she murmured. She shifted, suddenly aware of how little her nightgown concealed. As if he'd noticed too, his hand dropped from her neck and he cleared his throat. Well, she said, I suppose our mission just got a little more complicated. Oh, and why is that? She shook off the blush his touch had brought to her face and gave him a slow, wicked smile. Philip had no idea who he'd tried to dispatch, or of the world of pain that was headed his way. You didn't try to drown Adderland's assassin in a sewer and get away with it. Not in 1,000 lifetimes. Because, she said, my list of people to kill is now one person longer. And that was chapter 8. Ugh. If my nose had quit itching, I would be so happy. I would be the happiest person in the world if my nose had quit itching. It constantly feels like there's cat hair on my nose. And it's driving me bonkers. And it has been all day. But I think it's especially bad because I just sat outside for 15 minutes earlier. But whatever. I needed to get some outdoor time. Even though the outdoor hates me. Yeah. Okay. No. Come on, only half an hour left of reading. I can deal with my nose for another half hour. Maybe. Okay.
How long is the next chapter?
Not that long. It is... seven pages long. Okay. Okay, on to chapter 9. She slept until noon, took the two baths she'd promised herself, and then went to Arabin's study. He was nursing a cup of tea as she opened the door. I'm surprised to see you out of the bathtub, he said. Telling Sam the story about her month in the Red Desert had reminded her of why she'd wanted so badly to come home this summer, and of what she had accomplished. She had no reason now to tiptoe around Arabin, not after what he'd done, and what she'd been through. So Selena merely smiled at the King of Assassins as she held open the door for the servants outside. They carried in a heavy trunk, then another, and another. Do I dare ask? Arabin massaged his temples. The servants hurried out, and Selena shut the door behind them. Without a word, she opened the lids of the trunks. Gold shone in the noontime sun. She turned to Arabin, clinging to the memory of what it had felt like to sit on the roof after the party. His face was unreadable. I think this covers my debt, she said, forcing herself to smile. And then some. Arabin remained seated. She swallowed, suddenly feeling sick. Why had she thought this was a good idea? I want to keep working with you, she said carefully. He'd looked at her like this before, on the night he'd beaten her. But you don't own me anymore. His silver eyes flicked to the trunks, then to her. In a moment of silence that lasted forever, she stood still as he took her in. Then he smiled, a bit ruefully. Can you blame me for hoping that this day would never come? She almost sagged with relief. I mean it. I want to keep working with you. She knew in that moment that she couldn't tell him about the apartment, that she was moving out. Not right now. Small steps. Today the debt. Perhaps in a few weeks she could mention that she was leaving. Perhaps he wouldn't even care that she was getting her own home. And I'll always be happy to work with you, he said, but remained seated. He took a sip from his tea. Do I want to know where that money came from? She became aware of the scar on her neck as she said, The Beatmaster. Payment for saving his life. Arabin picked up the morning paper. Well, allow me to extend my congratulations. He looked at her over the top of the paper. You are now a free woman. She tried not to smile. Perhaps she wasn't free in the entire sense of the word, but at least he wouldn't be able to wield the debt against her anymore. That would suffice for now. Good luck with Donovan tomorrow night, he said. Let me know if you need any help. As long as you don't charge me for it. He didn't return her smile and set down the paper. I would never do that to you. Something like hurt flickered in his eyes. Fighting her sudden desire to apologize, she left his study without another word. The walk back to her bedroom was long. She'd expected to crow with glee when she gave him the money, expected to strut around the keep, but seeing the way he'd looked at her made all that gold feel cheap. A glorious start to her new future. Though Selena never wanted to set foot in the vile sewer again, she found herself back there that afternoon. There was still a river flowing through the tunnel, but the narrow walkway alongside it was dry, even with the rain shower that was now falling on the street above them. An hour before, Sam had just showered, had just showed up at her bedroom, dressed and ready to spy on Donovan's house. Now he crept behind her, saying nothing as they approached the iron doors she remembered all too well. She set down her torch beside the door and ran her hands along the worn, rusty surface. We'll have to get in this way tomorrow, she said, her voice barely audible at the gurgle of the sewer river. The front of the house is too well guarded now. Sam traced a finger through the groove between the door and the threshold. Aside from finding a way to haul a battering ram down here, I don't think we're getting through. She shot him a dark look. You could try knocking. Sam laughed under his breath. I'm sure the guards would appreciate that. Maybe they'd invite me in for an ale, too. That is, after they finished pumping my gut full of arrows. He patted the firm plane of his stomach. He was wearing the suit Arabin had forced him to buy, and she tried not to look too closely at how well it displayed his form. So, we can't get in this door, she murmured, sliding her hand along it again. Unless we figure out when the servants dump the trash. Unreliable, he countered, still studying the door. The servants might empty the trash whenever they feel like it. She swore and glanced about the sewer. What a horrible place to have almost died. She certainly hoped that she'd run into Philip tomorrow. That arrogant ass wouldn't see what was coming until she was right in front of him. He hadn't even recognized her from the party the other night. She smiled slowly. What better way to get back at Philip than to break in through the very door he'd revealed to her? Then one of us will just have to sit out here for a few hours, she whispered, still staring at the door. With the landing outside the door, the servants need to take a few steps to reach the water. Selena's smile grew. And I'm sure that if they're lugging a bunch of trash, they probably won't think to look behind them. Sam's teeth flashed in the torchlight as he smiled. And they'll be preoccupied long enough for someone to slip in and find a good hiding spot in the cellar to wait out the rest of the time until 7:30. What a surprise they'll have tomorrow when they find their cellar door locked. Unlocked. I think that'll be the least of their surprises tomorrow. She picked up her torch. It certainly will be. He followed her back down the sewer walkway. They'd found a grate in a shadowy alley, far enough away from the house that no one would suspect them. Unfortunately, it meant a long walk back to the sewers. I heard you paid off Arabin this morning, he said, his eyes on the dark stones beneath her feet. He still kept his voice soft. How does it feel to be free? She glanced at him sidelong. Not the way I thought it would. I'm surprised he accepted the money without a fight. She didn't say anything. In the dim light, Sam took a ragged breath. I think I might leave, he whispered. She almost tripped. Leave? He wouldn't look at her. I'm going down to Eelway, to Binjali to be precise. For a mission? It was common for Arabin to send them all over the continent, but the way Sam was speaking felt different. Forever, he said. Why? Her voice sounded a little shrill in her ears. He faced her. What do I have to tie me here? Arabin already mentioned that it might be useful to firmly establish ourselves in the south, too. Arabin, she seethed, fighting to keep her voice to a whisper. You talked to Arabin about this? Sam gave her a half shrug. Casually, it's not official. But Binjali is 1,000 miles away! Yes, but Rifthold belongs to you and Arabin. I'll always be an alternative. I'd rather be an alternative in Rifthold than ruler of the assassins in Binjali! She hated that she had to keep her voice so soft. She was going to splatter someone against the wall. She was going to rip down the sewer with her bare hands. I'm leaving at the end of the month, he said, still calm. That's 2 weeks away! Do I have any reason why I should stay here? Yes! She exclaimed as loudly as she could while still maintaining a hushed tone. Yes, you do! He didn't reply. You can't go! Give me a reason why I shouldn't. Because what was the point in anything if you just disappear forever? She hissed, splaying her arms. The point in what, Selena? How could it be so calm when she was so frantic? The point in Skull's Bay. The point in getting me that music. And the point in telling Arabin that you'd forgive him if he never hurt me again. You said you didn't care what I thought, or what I did, or if I died, if I'm not mistaken. I lied, and you know I lied, you stupid bastard! He laughed quietly. You want to know how I spent this summer? She went still. He ran a hand through his brown hair. I spent every single day fighting the urge to slit Arabin's throat, and he knew I wanted to kill him. I'll kill you, Sam had screamed at Arabin. The moment I woke up after he beat me, I realized I had to leave, because I was going to kill him if I didn't. But I couldn't. He studied her face. Not until you came back. Not until I knew you were all right. Until I saw that you were safe. Breathing became very, very hard. He knew that too, Sam went on. So he decided to exploit it. He didn't recommend me for missions. Instead, he made me help Lysandra and Clarice. He made me escort them around the city on picnics and parties. It became a game between the two of us. How much of his horse shit I could take before I snapped. But we both knew he'd always have the winning hand. He'd always have you. Still, I spent every day this summer hoping you'd come back in one piece. More than that, I hoped you'd come back and take revenge for what he'd done to you. But she hadn't. She'd come back and let Arabin shower her with gifts. And now that you're fine, Selena, now that you've paid off your debt, I can't stay in Rifthold. Not after all the things he's done to us. She knew it was selfish and horrible, but she whispered, please don't go. He let out an uneven breath. You'll be fine without me. You always have been. Maybe once, but not now. How can I convince you to stay? You can't. She threw down the torch. You want me to beg? Is that it? No, never. Then tell me. What more can I say? He exploded, his whisper rough and harsh. I've already told you everything. I've already told you that if I stay here, if I have to live with Arabin, I'll snap his damned neck. But why? Why can't you let it go? He grabbed her shoulders and shook her. Because I love you. Her mouth fell open. I love you, he repeated, shaking her again. I have for years, and he hurt you and made me watch because he's always known how I felt too. But if I asked you to pick, you'd choose Arabin, and I can't take it. The only sounds were their breathing, an uneven beat against the rushing of the sewer river. You're a damned idiot, she breathed. You're a moron and an ass and a damned idiot. He looked like she had hit him, but she went on and grasped both sides of his face. Because I'd pick you, and then kissed him. And that was chapter 9. Yeah, guys, that happened. That happened. How long is chapter 10? Oh, chapter 10's also not that long. We can read chapter 10, too. I know, it is very cliche, but it's also cute. Okay, on to chapter 10. She'd never kissed anyone, and as her lips met his and he wrapped his arms around her waist, pulling her close against him, she honestly had no idea why she'd waited so long. His mouth was warm and soft, his body wondrously solid against hers, his hair silken as she threaded her fingers through it. Still, she let him guide her, forced herself to remember to breathe as he eased her lips apart with his own. When she felt the brush of his tongue against hers, she was so full of lightning she thought she might die from the rush of it. She wanted more. She wanted all of him. She couldn't hold him tight enough, kiss him fast enough. A growl rumbled in the back of his throat, so full of need she felt it in her core. Lower than that, actually. She pushed him against the wall, and his hands roamed all over her back, her sides, her hips. She wanted to bask in the feeling, wanted to rip off her suit so she could feel his calloused hands against her bare skin. The intensity of that desire swept her away. She didn't give a damn about the sewers, or Donoval, or Philip, or Arabin. Sam's lips left her mouth as to travel along her neck. They grazed a spot beneath her ear and her breath hitched. No, she didn't give a damn about anything right now. It was nighttime when they left the sewers, hair disheveled and mouth swollen. He wouldn't let go of her hand during the long walk back to the keep, and when they got there, she ordered the servants to send dinner to them to her room. Though they stayed up long into the night, doing a minimal amount of talking, their clothes remained on. Enough had happened today to change her life, and she was in no particular mood to alter yet another major thing. But what had happened in the sewer? Selena lay awake that night, long after Sam had left her room, staring at nothing. He loved her, for years, and he'd endured so much for her sake. For the life of her, she couldn't understand why. She'd been nothing but horrible to him, and had repaid any kindness on his part with a sneer. And what she felt for him, she hadn't been in love with him for years. Until Skulls Bay, she wouldn't have minded killing him. But now, no, she couldn't think about this now. And she couldn't think about it tomorrow either. Because tomorrow, they'd infiltrate Donovan's house. It was still risky, but the payoff. She couldn't turn down that money. Not now that she would be supporting herself. And she wouldn't let the bastard Donovan get away with a slave trade agreement, or blackmailing those who dared to stand against it. She just prayed Sam wouldn't get hurt. In the silence of her bedroom, she swore an oath to the moonlight that if Sam were hurt, no force in the world would hold her back from slaughtering everyone responsible. After lunch the next afternoon, Selena waited in the shadows beside the sewer door to the cellar. A ways down the tunnel, Sam also waited, his black suit making him almost invisible in the darkness. With the household lunch just ending, it was a good bet that Selena would soon have her best chance to slip inside. She'd been waiting for an hour already, each noise whetting the edge she'd been riding since dawn. She'd have to be quick and silent and ruthless. One mistake, one shout, or even a missing servant might ruin everything. A servant had to come down here to deposit the trash at some point soon. She pulled a little pocket watch out of her suit. Carefully, she lit a match to glance at the face. 2 o'clock. She had 5 hours until she needed to creep into Donovan's study to await the 7:30 meeting. And she was willing to bet he wouldn't enter the study until then. A man like that would want to greet his guest at the door, to see the look on his partner's face as he led him through the opulent halls. Suddenly, she heard the first interior door to the sewers groan, and footsteps and grunts sounded. Her trained ear heard the noises of one servant, female. Selena blew out the match. She pressed herself into the wall as the lock to the outer door snapped open, and the heavy door slid against the ground. She could hear no other footsteps, save for the woman who hauled a vat of garbage onto the landing. The servant was alone. The cellar above was empty, too. The woman, too preoccupied with depositing the metal pail of garbage, didn't think to look to the shadows beside the door. She didn't even pause as Selena slipped past her. Selena was through both doors, up the stairs and into the cellar before she even heard the plop and splatter of the trash landing in the water. As Selena rushed toward the darkest corner of the vast, dimly lit cellar, she took in as many details as she could. Countless of barrels of wine and shelves crammed full of food and goods from across Aurelia. One staircase leading up, no other servants to be heard, save for somewhere above her. The kitchen, probably. The outer door slammed shut, the lock sounding. But Selena was already crouched behind a giant keg of wine. The interior door also shut and locked. Selena slid on the smooth black mask she'd brought with her, tossing the hood of her cloak over her hair. The sound of footsteps and light panting, and then the servant reappeared at the top of the sewer stairs, empty garbage pail creaking as it swung from one hand. She walked right by, humming to herself as she mounted the stairs that led toward the kitchen. Selena loosed a breath when the woman's footsteps faded, and then grinned her to herself. If Philip had been smart, he would have slit her throat in the sewer that night. Perhaps when she killed him, she'd let him know exactly how she got into the house. When she was absolutely certain that the servant wasn't returning with a second pail of garbage, Selena hurried toward the small set of steps that led down to the sewer. Quiet as a jackrabbit in the red desert, she unlocked the first door, crept through, then unlocked the second. Sam wouldn't sneak in until right before the meeting, or else someone might come down and discover him preparing the cellar for the fire that would serve as a distraction. And if someone found the two unlocked doors before then, it could just be blamed on the servant who dumped the trash. Selena carefully shut both doors, making sure the locks remained disabled, and then returned to her place in the shadows of the cellar's vast wine collection. Then she waited. At 7, she left the cellar before Sam could arrive with his torches and oil. The ungodly amount of alcohol stocked inside would do the rest. She just hoped he made it out before the fire blew the cellar to bits. She needed to be upstairs and hidden before that happened, and before the exchange was made. Once the fire started a few minutes after 7:30, some of the guards would be called downstairs immediately, leaving Donovan and his partner with far fewer men to protect them. The servants were eating their evening meal, and from the laughter inside the sub-level kitchen, none of them seemed aware of the deal that was to occur three flights above them. Selena crept past the kitchen door. In her suit, cloak, and mask, she was a mere shadow on the pale stone walls. She held her breath the entire way up the servants' narrow spiral staircase. With her new suit, it was far easier to keep track of her weapons, and she slid a long dagger out of the hidden flap in her boot. She peered down the second-floor hallway. The wooden doors were all shut. No guards, no servants, no members of Donovan's household. She eased a foot onto the wooden floorboards. Where the hell were the guards? Swift and quiet as a cat, she was at the door to Donovan's study. No light shone from beneath the door. She saw no shadows of feet and heard no sound. The door was locked. A minor inconvenience. She sheathed her dagger and pulled out two narrow bits of metal, wedging and jamming them into the lock until... click! Then she was inside, door locked again, and she stared into the inky black of the interior. Frowning, Selena fished the pocket watch out of her suit. She lit a match. She still had enough time to look around. Selena flicked out the match and rushed to the curtains, shutting them tight against the night outside. Rain still plinked faintly against the covered windows. She moved to the massive oak desk in the center of the room and lit the oil lamp atop it, dimming it until only a faint blue flame gave off a flicker of light. She shuffled through the papers on the desk. Newspapers, casual letters, receipts, the household expenses. She opened every drawer in the desk, more of the same. Where were those documents? Swallowing her violent curse, Selena put a fist into her mouth. She turned in place. An armchair, an armoire, a hutch. She searched the hutch and armoire, but they had nothing. Just empty papers and ink. Her ears strained for any sound of approaching guards. She scanned the books on the bookcase, tapping her fingers across the spines, trying to hear if any were hollowed out, trying to hear if... A floorboard creaked beneath her feet. She was down on her knees in an instant, rapping on the dark, polished wood. She knocked all around the area until she found a hollow sound. Carefully, heart hammering, she dug her dagger between the floorboards and wedged it upward. Papers stared back at her. She pulled them out, replacing the floorboard, and was back at the desk a moment later, spreading the papers before her. She'd only glance at them, just to be sure she had the right documents. Her hands trembled as she flipped through the papers, one after another. Maps with red marks in random places, charts with numbers and names, list after list of names and locations, cities, towns, forests, mountains, all in Melisandre. These weren't just Melisandres opposed to slavery. These were locations for planned safe houses to smuggle slaves to freedom. This was enough information to get all these people executed or enslaved themselves. And Donovan, that wretched bastard, was going to use this information to force those people to support the slave trade, or be turned over to the king. Selena gathered up the documents. She'd never let Donovan get away with this. Never. She took a step toward the trick floorboard, then she heard the voices. And that was chapter 10. I think we have enough time to do chapter 11 as well. But that'll be the last chapter. Chapter 11. She had the lamp off and the curtains opened in a heartbeat, swearing silently as she tucked the documents into her suit and hid in the armoire. It would only take a few moments before Donovan and his partner found that the documents were missing. But that was all she needed. She just had to get them in here, away from the guards, long enough to take them both down. The fire would start in the cellar any minute now, hopefully distracting many of the other guards, and hopefully happening before Donovan noticed the papers were gone. She left the armoire door open a crack, peering out. The study door unlocked and then swung open. "Brandy?" Donovan was saying to the cloaked and hooded man who trailed in behind him. "No," the man said, removing his hood. He was of average height and plain, his only noticeable features, his sun-kissed face and high cheekbones. Who was he? "Eager to get it over with?" Donovan chuckled. but there was a hitch to his voice. You could say that, the man replied coldly. Coolly. He looked about the room, and Selena didn't dare move or breathe as his blue eyes passed over the armoire. My partner's known to start looking for me in 30 minutes. I'll have you out in 10. I have to be at the theater tonight. Anyway, there's a young lady I'm particularly keen to see, Donovan said with a businessman's charm. I take it that your associates are prepared to act quickly and give me a response by dawn? They are, but show me your documents first. I need to see what they're offering. Of course, Donovan said, drinking from the glass of brandy that he poured for himself. Selena's hands became slick and her face turned sweaty under the mask. Do you live here, or are you visiting? When the man didn't respond, Donovan said with a grin, Either way, I hope you've stopped by Madame Clarisse's establishment. I've never seen such fine girls in all my life. The man gave Donovan a distinctly displeased stare. Had Selena not been here to kill them, she might have liked the stranger. Not one for chit-chat, Donovan teased, setting down the brandy and walking toward the floorboard. From the slight tremble in Donovan's hands, she could tell that his talking was all nervous babble. How had such a man come into contact with such incredibly delicate and important information? Donovan knelt before the loose floorboard and folded up. He swore. Selena flicked the sword out of the hidden compartment in her suit and moved. She was out of the closet before they even looked at her, and Donovan died a heartbeat after that. His blood sprayed from the spine-severing wound she gave him through the back of his neck, and the other man let out a shout. She whirled toward him, the sword flicking blood. An explosion rocked the house so strong that she lost her footing. What in hell had Sam detonated down there? That was all the man needed. He was out the study door. His speed was admirable. He moved like someone used to a lifetime of running. She was through the threshold almost instantly. Smoke was already rising from the stairs. She turned left after the man, only to run into Philip, the bodyguard. She rebounded away as he swiped with a sword for her face. Behind him, the man was still running, and he glanced over his shoulder once before he sprinted down the stairs. What have you done? Philip spat, noticing the blood on her blade. He didn't need to see whose face was under the mask to identify her. He must have recognized the suit. She deployed the sword in her other arm, too. Get the hell out of my way! The mask made her words low and gravelly, the voice of a demon, not a young woman. She slashed the swords in front of her, a deadly whine coming off of them. I'm going to rip you limb from limb, Philip growled. Just try it. Philip's face twisted in rage as he launched himself at her. She took the first blow on her left blade, her arm aching at the impact, and Philip barely moved away fast enough to avoid her punching the right blade straight through his gut. He struck again, a clever thrust toward her ribs, but she blocked him. He pressed both of her blades. Up close, she could see his weapon was of impressive quality. I wanted to make this last, Selena hissed, but I think it's going to be quick. Far cleaner than the death you tried to give me. Philip shoved her back with a roar. You have no idea what you've just done. She swung her swords in front of her again. I know exactly what I've just done, and I know exactly what I'm about to do. Philip charged, but the hallway was too narrow and his blow too undisciplined. She got past his guard instantly. His blood soaked her gloved hand. Her sword whined against bone as she whipped it out again. Philip's eyes went wide and he staggered back, clutching the slender wound that went up through his ribs and into his heart. Fool, he whispered, slumping to the ground. Did Lifer hire you? She didn't say anything as he struggled for breath, blood bubbling from his lips. Donovan, Philip rasped, loved his country. He took a wet breath, hate and grief mingling in his eyes. You don't know anything. He was dead a moment later. Maybe, she said as she looked down at his body. But I knew enough just then. It had taken less than 2 minutes. That was it. She knocked out two guards as she catapulted down the stairs of the burning house and out of the front door, disarming another three when she vaulted over the iron fence and into the streets of the capital. Where in the hell had the man gone? There were no alleys from the house to the river, so he hadn't gone left, which meant he had gone either straight through the alley ahead of her or to the right. He wouldn't have gone to the right. That was the main avenue of the city, where the wealthy lived. She took the alley straight ahead. She sprinted so fast she could hardly breathe, snapping her swords back into their hidden compartment. No one noticed her. Most people were too busy rushing toward the flames, now licking the sky above Donovan's house. What had happened to Sam? She spotted the man then, sprinting down an alley that led toward the Avery. She almost missed him, because he was around the corner and gone the next instant. He'd mentioned his partners. Was he headed to them now? Would he be that foolish? She splashed through the puddles and leftover trash and grabbed the wall of a building as she hauled herself around the corner, right into a dead end. The man was trying to scale the large brick wall at the other end. The buildings surrounding them had no doors and no windows low enough for him to reach. Selena popped out both of her swords as she slowed to a stalking gait. The man made one last leap for the top of the wall, but couldn't reach. He fell hard against the cobblestone streets. Sprawled on the ground, he twisted toward her. His eyes were bright as he pulled out a pile of papers from his worn jacket. What sort of documents had he been bringing to Donneville? Their official business contract? Go to hell, he spat, and a match flared. The papers were instantly alight, and he threw them to the ground. So fast she could hardly see it, he grabbed a vial from his pocket and swallowed the contents. She lunged toward him, but she was too late. By the time she grabbed him, he was dead. Even with his eyes closed, the rage remained on his face. He was gone. Irrevocably gone. But for what? Some business deal gone sour? Easing him to the ground, she jumped swiftly to her feet. She stomped on the papers, extinguishing the flame in seconds. But half of them had already burned, leaving only scraps. In the moonlight, she knelt on the damp cobblestones and picked up the remnants of the documents he'd been so willing to die for. It wasn't merely a trade agreement, like the papers she had in her pocket. These contained names and numbers and locations of safe houses. But these were in Adderlin, even stretching as far north as the border with Terrasen. She whipped her head to the body. It didn't make any sense. Why kill himself to keep this information secret when he'd planned to share it with Donneville and use it for his own profit? Heaviness rushed through her veins. You know nothing, Philip had said. Somehow, it suddenly felt very true. How much had Arabin known? Philip's words sounded in her ears again and again. It didn't add up. Something was wrong. Something was off. No one had told her these documents would be this extensive, this damning to the people they listed. Her hands shaking, she shifted his body into a sitting position so he wouldn't be face first in the filthy ground. Why had he sacrificed himself to keep this information safe? Noble or not, foolish or not, she couldn't let it go. She straightened his coat. Then she picked up his half-destroyed documents, lit a match, and let them burn until they were nothing but ashes. It was the only thing she had to offer. She found Sam slumped against the wall of another alley. She rushed to him where he knelt with a hand over his chest, panting heavily. Are you hurt? She demanded, scanning the alley for any sign of guards. An orange glow spread behind them. She hoped the servants had gotten out of Donneville's house in time. I'm fine, Sam rasped, but in the moonlight, she could see the gash on his arm. The guard spotted me in the cellar and shot at me. He grabbed at the breast of his suit. One of them hit me right in the heart. I thought I was dead, but the arrow clattered right out. It didn't even touch my skin. He peeled open the gash in the front of his suit, and a glimmer of iridescence sparkled. Spider silk, he murmured, his eyes wide. Selena smiled grimly and pulled off the mask from her face. No wonder this damn suit was so expensive, Sam said, letting out a breathy laugh. She didn't feel the need to tell him the truth. He searched her face. It's done then? She leaned down to kiss him, a swift brush of her mouth against his. It's done, she said onto his lips. And that was chapter 11. Also, thank you, Mom, for the bless you. I love having seasonal libraries. Woo, so much fun. Well, we are going to call it there, reading-wise. And we are going to find somebody to raid. Okay, who is live right now? Ooh, Artie is live playing Valorant. Of course, we're gonna go raid Artie. We love Artie here. But thank you everyone for hanging out with me tonight. I know this week has been kind of hectic with streams. I know I canceled Monday's stream and then just didn't stream Wednesday. Forgot to tell you guys I wasn't streaming Wednesday. It was a bit hectic with planning and stuff for getting a new fridge. Which I did get my new fridge. It is all set up now. And I should be pretty good the next couple weeks, stream-wise. I should be on my normal schedule. It's going to be kind of busy, around here a little bit, as I'm gonna have people visiting for the next 3 weeks. But those are all, you know, good friends that you guys know already, and they know, you know, that I stream and that my streaming schedule. In fact, in 2 weeks, we should have a guest reader. Clayton is coming to visit, and she said she would like to do some reading. So we might have a guest reader, and so we might take turns doing chapter by chapter. Kind of like, Mom, if you're still listening, kind of like how we used to do when we were reading books together growing up. So, yeah. Anyways, we're gonna go ahead and, RIP Nightbot sub. So sad. If Misty was watching, I'm sure she would gift a sub to Nightbot. She's like the one that keeps Nightbot going. But anyways, thank you guys so much for hanging out with me tonight. We're gonna go ahead and raid Artie. Make sure you give Artie lots of love. We love him to pieces. If you are subbed, copy and paste the raid message with the Lawina emotes. If you are not subbed, copy and paste the raid message with the bleeding hearts. But make sure you only copy and paste once, as we do not want to spam. I love y'all to pieces, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye!